Welcome students to the lecture on Technical Textiles 2. In today's lecture, we will be discussing on Unit 2. The topic is Chemical Protective Clothing. So, from the name itself, you can understand Chemical Protective Clothing means to protect the human beings from the attack of chemicals. So, the purpose of Chemical Protective Clothing or CPC is to isolate the parts of the body from direct contact with the hazardous material. So whenever during the chemical operation, it is not always apparent when the exposure will occur. So many chemicals pose invisible hazards and offer no warning properties. Without any warning or without any kind of a signal, the accident may occur during the chemical operation. So no matter how the effective the workers' exposure to hazardous material, it should be minimized through the engineering controls, that is isolating the body from the chemicals, or administrative controls, that is the avoidance. So where these chemical protective clothing is used, the application of CPC is to protect the farmers from insecticides, then to protect the drivers from toxic materials, flammable materials during the loading or unloading, asbestos removal and other particulate operation, then firefighters from chemical substances. So the application of the CPC is through this minimum these four places where this CPC is used is which I have told. So for example, if you take asbestos removal, asbestos is a carcinogenic chemical which when inhaled through nose, it will create cancer. So in that case, a highly effective chemical protective clothing is necessary to protect the wearer from inhalation of asbestos. So these four are the brief applications of the chemical protective clothing. Now we will see what are chemical hazards. A chemical hazard is a type of an occupational hazard caused by exposures to chemicals in the workplace. It is like a chemical hazard. So, like an accident. So, exposure to chemicals in the workplace can cause acute or long-term detrimental health effects. So, what are all the types of health effects will occur that we will see, like neurotoxins, immune agents, dermatologic agents, carcinogens, reproductive toxins, systemic toxins, osmogens, pneumoconiotic agents and sensitizers. Because of the use of the dangerous chemicals, that is the hazardous chemicals, it will affect the nervous tissues, it will affect the immune system, it will affect the skin, it causes cancer, it will affect the reproductive system, it will affect the lungs by creating asthma, it will create some lungs disorder also, and also other problems also will occur because of the exposure of these hazardous chemicals. So these hazards can cause physical and or health risks. So depending upon the chemical, the hazards involved may be varied. Various types of chemicals will give different types of problems. So that's it is important to know and apply the PPE, especially during the lab. Hope you may all be knowing what is meant by PPE. So depending upon the chemical and the hazard involved, it may be varied. Thus, it is important to know and apply the PPE, especially during the laboratory. So what are the types of chemical hazards? There are a number of chemical hazards which is shown in this figure. You can see flammable, corrosive, reactive, toxic, irritant, environmental hazards. And right side also a brief description of what are the chemical hazards that can cause, that is shown here. You can see flammable means the material, whatever chemical that is used, like methanol or diesel fuel or spirits that are used, that are flammable. Corrosive means which will cause some visible destruction at the point of contact, like acetic acid or sodium hydroxide. These are all the corrosive materials. Reactive means which are liable to explode and react violently on contact with air or water or chemicals, like benzoyl peroxide, nitric acid, picric acid, which is an explosive, and silane, sodium metal. These are the examples of the reactive type of chemicals. Toxic means which is poisonous. We have seen in the previous slide itself, like neurotoxin and systemic toxin. So these toxins will harm if they enter the body, such as carcinogens, mutagens, and then poison, which creates cancer. Examples are benzene, bromine, powdered inks, pigments, azides, and then formaldehydes. Irritant. Irritant means material which cause harm by irritating the eyes and or the skin and cause allergic reactions. That is drowsiness. It creates some drowsy feeling. And then lack of coordination. That is the concentration impairment and or organ damage. These are the irritants. Another is the environmental hazard. Environmental hazard means materials which are toxic and are cause the harm to the environment at large, particularly to the aquatic animals like sea animals. For example, anthrax, arsenic, asbestos, lead, mercury, oil, like high metals, that is the high density metals, if this get released to the environment. These are heavy metals, you can say. These get, when it gets released to the environment, it will surely create a danger to the aquatic life also. So there are various types of chemical hazards are there. So to protect the nature and also to protect the human beings from attack, from the attack from the chemicals, this personal protective equipment has to be worn. So what are the levels of protection? The Environmental Protection Agency or EPA, it has defined four levels of protection. One is the level A, which is the first level. The protection offers the highest protection from the skin and the respiratory exposure to chemical hazards. You can see it protects the skin and also the respiratory exposure. So the protection of level A must be gas and vapor tight and external contaminant from reaching the wearer. It is completely closed without even not allowing even the gas or the vapor also. So level A ensemble includes self-contained breathing apparatus. So the level A type of a protective clothing should contain the SCBA, which is the self-contained breathing apparatus. That is, breathing apparatus is inside, is a part of personal protective equipment itself. Next is the level B. Level B protection must prevent the passage of any liquid into the ensemble. Ensemble means like a clothing layers. So it should prevent the passage of any liquid to the ensemble, but it may not prevent the penetration of gases or vapors. So one day it is a liquid resistant, but it is not the gas or the vapor resistant. Liquid resistant means chemicals, but it will not prevent the passage of gases or vapors. So it will allow the toxic gases or vapors also to pass through. Next is SCBA is used for respiratory protection, but here also the respiratory protection is used. Level C is same as clothing as level B, but with air purity respirator. Means here we are not using the self-contained breathing apparatus, that is SCBA we are not using, but here we are using a air purity respirator, that is the level C. So level C system provides limited protection from minor contamination. Level C protection is not usually used by emergency response personnel. And level D is the last level, which is the normal work clothing in a chemical environment to keep off the dirt, grease, limited spill protection, etc. And it is not considered protective clothing by emergency response personnel. So you can understand that when the levels of A and B are highly protective, level A is especially the best in giving the protection, and the next is the level B, and when the level reduces to C and D, the protection level goes away. So you can see this picture which is shown here. This is the level A, which contains the SCBA, that is the self-contained breathing apparatus here, so that it is completely enclosed. The person who is wearing this is completely is within inside, which is totally covered with the garment, with the gloves, and the total body is covered with the SCBA. And here you can see the hood and the lens, and everything is there along with the boots also. And level B, as I have told you, this also contains the self-contained breathing apparatus. You can see, but here the garment can only prevent the liquid from going inside, but it will allow the gas and vapor to go inside. It will only prevent the liquid from going inside, but it will allow the gas and vapor. And level C, you can see it contains the air purity respirator, you can see here, but it is not used by the emergency personnel, so it is does not give that kind of a protection. Yep. And level D is totally free. You can see here there is no kind of a respirator or a self-contained breathing apparatus. So level D does not give any protection. Only thing is that when any chemical or dirt or grease, if it spills on, that can only be resisted like a normal garment with the gloves and boots, you can see. So these are the four levels of protection. Now, coming down to the types of chemical protective clothing, there are two types of chemical protective clothing which you should know. One is the encapsulating and another one is the non-encapsulating. Encapsulating, from the word itself, you can understand you are encapsulating something, you are closing something with a capsule, so that the person is inside and he is totally covered with the garment. That is the meaning. So encapsulating ensemble covers the whole body, including the respiratory protection equipment. Even he is totally, the whole body is covered, including the respiratory protective equipment. So the garment encloses everything, including the respiratory protection equipment. And this encapsulating garments usually provide better chemical protection, which we have already seen in the. So all level A and level B, which we have seen, are encapsulating. You can see the picture once again. These both level A and level B are encapsulating type. And non-encapsulating system is assembled from separate components, maybe one outside the shirt. Non-encapsulating system usually applies to level B or below. You can say this level C and D are definitely, it is the non-encapsulating, means separate parts like this hood and this garment and the gloves, boots, everything is totally separated, including the air respirator, whichever he is using, the coveralls, everything is separated, so that they are separately, whichever is separated, that are assembled. That is the non-encapsulating type, where it is assembled from the separate components. So it can be one outside the shirt. So this is the non-encapsulating, like example is level C and level D. So you can see here, this is the best example for the encapsulating thing. The person is inside and he is totally covered, including the self-contained breathing apparatus. But here you can see, this is the non-encapsulating type of a garment, where you can see the self-contained breathing apparatus is not a part of garment, but it is separately kept. And here you can see the face portion, which is covered with the hood, and also there is some connection with the respirator, which is also kept outside. So this is not a encapsulating, this is a non-encapsulating type of a garment. So now we will move on to discussion about the types of fibers that are used to make the chemical protective clothing. So what type of materials can be used? There are various types of materials that can be used, and depending upon the application, the material varies. For example, you can see here butyl nylon, supported elastomer, splash or encapsulating suits, butyl rubber. Then you can see a number of compounds like chlorinated polyethylene, fluorinated propylene, natural rubber, neoprene. And there are various, for various applications like gloves, visors, splash suits or encapsulating suits, there are various types of materials that are recommended here, which is shown here. And it can be, material can be used in the form of any type, like an elastomer or like a plastic laminate, like that you can use. So in different type of application, these kind of materials can be made into a different material and it can be used. But one thing, if you observe from the amount of the number of materials that are used, that is the fibers, whichever is shown here, but you can see there is no presence of any kind of a conventional synthetic fibers like a polyester or a polypropylene or a polyethylene. Even polyethylene, it is not there, conventional polyethylene, whichever is shown here. That is not shown here. Did you notice that? Why it is not shown? Because the conventional synthetic materials, though it has the good chemical protection. For example, if you take polyester, polyester has good acid resistance. If you put acid, it will not get easily attacked by the acids. Or if you take even polypropylene, polypropylene does not contain any kind of a reactive groups. It is chemically inert, but still those kind of materials are not put in this table. If you notice from top to bottom, is there any presence of polypropylene or polyester? It is not there. So here most of the materials that are bought is something different, which contains, for example, here you can see it is a chlorinated polyethylene or a butyl rubber or a butyl nylon or a nitrile rubber or something like polyethylene coated Tyvek. All the materials are different. So the criteria is the conventional fibers, whichever contains, whichever is like polyester or polyethylene or polypropylene, those all contains the aliphatic hydrogen atoms, and those fibers, though it has a good chemical resistance to some extent, it will be affected by oxidizing agents also. If any kind of an oxidizing agent is also is attacking the material fiber, these fibers will get affected. So whatever fibers that are used for the chemical protective clothing, those fibers should not contain the aliphatic compounds only. It should mainly contain the aromatic analogs. So these aromatic chains, whichever is there, that will not easily prone to hydrolysis by the oxidizing agents. So most of the fibers, whichever is selected, for example, here you can see one of the example here, fluorinated ethylene propylene like Teflon. Teflon means something like a polytetrafluoroethylene, which is highly inert fiber. So these kind of fibers which are highly inert without any kind of a groups like ester or amides, which are easily prone to hydrolysis, those kind of materials are used. And also a single fiber is not used, multiple fibers are used, and along with many layers also. So this is how the materials that are used for the chemical protective clothing does working. So we will now move on to further about the chemical protective materials. There are three types of protection that is important in for conferring the chemical protection. One is the particulate protection, another is the liquid and gas protection, and next is the chemical and biological protection. So first we will see the particulate protection. So particulate protection means any kind of a particles, like from the through the chemicals, any kind of a dust or any particle, if it is attacking our skin. In that case, if our garment is chemical protective garment we are wearing, if our garment is able to protect us from the particulate, then you can claim that it is a particulate protective textile. So for this particulate protection, generally the porous fabrics are used. So what are the types of materials that can be used for particulate protection? The best example is spun bonded olefins. Hope you may be knowing what is meant by olefin, like polyethylene and polypropylene. So, but here it is not a normal polyethylene or polypropylene, it is something different. It is the spun bonded olefin, which we will see. The example is Tyvek. Next is the hydro entangled spun lace, example Sontara. And number three is cellulosic materials, example K-cell. And next is the spun bond melt-blown smalt bond. This you may be knowing, which is the SMS type of a composite material also. It can be used. The company name is CleanGuard. So these four are the recommended type of a materials that are used for the particulate protective textiles. First we will see what is meant by spun bonded olefin, which we have seen. The example is a Tyvek. What is a Tyvek? Tyvek is a spun bonded high density polyethylene material developed by DuPont. DuPont developed this material. It is manufactured through a spun bonded non-woven process, and it is not the normal polyethylene, it is the high density polyethylene. This Tyvek is normally used in material wrapping, like envelopes. Many envelopes are made of this Tyvek fibers. For example, if you happen to see the courier company named FedEx, that company uses a envelope that is made up of Tyvek. There you can even write also with the pen or the sketch also in the over the envelope. And this Tyvek is used in other applications also, like during for building construction also this Tyvek is used for wrapping the building to protect it from the rain or any kind of other environmental disturbances. So this Tyvek is used for textile also, for chemical protection, and also for medical garments also this Tyvek is used, especially during the attack from to prevent the wearer from doctors from getting attacked from the any kind of viruses also, like COVID-19, which is now going on, like that, any kind of a SARS or any kind of a viral resistance also this Tyvek gives by giving a very compact, this Tyvek has a very compact structure. So this can be used for a number of medical gowns also can be made up of Tyvek. So these Tyvek has a high strength, low permeability, and meets the federal flammability requirements. So it has a good flammability requirement also. So it has a high strength, low permeability, which we are more interested in our chemical protective clothing, so that it does not easily allow any kind of a particulate to penetrate inside the garment. This is formed by a continuous process from very fine 0.5 to 10 micrometer fibers. So very minute type of a fibers can be taken. Those non-directional fibers are first spun and then bonded by heat and pressure. It is like a spun bonded technique. It is a spun bonded technique where the fibers are first spun without any kind of a binder or filler. We do not add any kind of a binder or filler, but we just make a bonding with the help of a heat and pressure. And advantages are, this Tyvek is difficult to tear, but it can be easily cut with scissors or a knife, but it can be sewn to make garments. Another great advantage of Tyvek is, water vapor can pass through the Tyvek, but liquid water cannot. So the person who is wearing a Tyvek garment, he can actually, when he perspires, it will allow the water vapor to pass through and go outside, but it will not allow the external chemical or any kind of a particles to penetrate inside. So all of these properties have led to Tyvek being used in a variety of application, and an anti-static treatment also can be given to the Tyvek so that you can prevent the static charge generation in the Tyvek, because it is a highly synthetic material. So another material which can be used for the chemical protective clothing is Sontara. Sontara is a spun-laced non-woven fabric that is made up of both polyester and cellulose. So here, these materials are treated to be flame retardant. It is suitable for garment making, however, the barrier properties are moderate. It is not as effective like a Tyvek. So here, this polyester and cellulose, since they are used, so it is to be treated to be flame retardant, because polyester and cellulose, these are easily catchable by the fire, easily it will burn. So it should be treated to be flame retardant. And also DuPont developed aramid versions of Sontara available in 100% Nomex, Nomex or Kevlar blend and other combinations. So not only the polyester and cellulose, they have developed other versions or other aramid versions like Nomex or Nomex Kevlar type of a blend, and other combinations are also were used. So these, you can say, like a Sontara or Tyvek, these are contaminant resistant garments. Any kind of a contaminants like asbestos or any kind of a dust which can affect the human body, those kind of contaminants can be resisted by wearing this kind of a garments made up of Tyvek or Clean Guard also, we will see. So there is another company called Clean Guard. They have made one material for the chemical protective clothing that is the similar to the SMS type of a material, where the outer surface is made up of a spun bonded polypropylene, and the inner surface is made up of a melt bond polypropylene, and again the outer surface, the other surface is made up of a spun bonded polypropylene. You can say that melt blown polypropylene is sandwiched between spun bonded polypropylene. So here the criteria is the outside layer gives the strength, that is the spun bonded polypropylene gives the strength, and the inner layer provides the barrier protection. And the advantage is here the clean guard has a good breathability, which makes it suitable for closed areas. So it is an advantage, yes. Like similar to the face mask that people are wearing, like where the melt blown is sandwiched in between both the layers. So those here, this kind of a material can be used for chemical protective clothing. Next, we will move on to the next type of a protection. One is the liquid and gas protection. So far we have discussed about only the particulate protection. We were not bothered that much about the liquid and gas protection. When it comes to liquid and gas protection, it means that the garment should resist both the liquid as well as the gas. So fabrics which are coated or laminated with special chemicals are suitable for chemical protection involving liquids and gases. They are used in hazardous or toxic material handling. So it should resist both the liquid and gas. So what is the example for this kind of a liquid and gas protection? We have seen a number of examples in the table, which you can have further. Once more you can see there are various types of materials, from butyl nylon, butyl rubber, various types of materials we have seen. So from this we are going to choose some materials, in we are keeping it in different layers. We have like a multi-layer structure we are going to make, where this liquid and gas protection can be obtained. So here the outside layer is made up of a low density polyethylene, and the second layer is made up of sarin. Hope some of you may be remembering about this name called as sarin. Sarin is nothing but like a fluorinated fiber, like polyvinylidene dichloride, PVDC. So that is the sarin fiber. This fiber has a very good chemical resistance. It can protect the wearer from acids, alkalis, and other type of solvents like perchloroethylene, which is a volatile type of a solvents also. It can protect. So this is the second layer, and third layer is the ethylene vinyl acetate copolymer. This is the third layer. This is actually like a binder which will actually bind these number of layers, and Tyvek is the inner layer which is close to the skin. Here this ethylene vinyl acetate, which is used in the third layer, it acts as an adhesive, which I have told you it is like a binder. So this Saranex 23P, it is a multi-layer structure. You can see there are four layers that are shown here. Something like this, you can see four layers. So this Saranex is very suitable for garment manufacturing with various seam types. So you can laminate 1.325 mil of polyethylene with Tyvek. That is the low density polyethylene with the Tyvek. A tough fabric with good barrier properties is produced, that is suitable for manufacturing with different seam types. So you can make a heavy garment, like a tough garment that you can make, so that the person who is wearing it can protect himself from the liquid and gas wherever the chemical exposure is there. There this garment can be used. So this is what I have shown you. There is another product which is made by DuPont, is the Barricade. This Barricade is another type of a product made by DuPont with good barrier qualities. Barrier, you know what is meant by barrier. Barrier is something like a obstruction. So here also a multi-layer film can be laminated to a substrate of polypropylene. For better protection, total encapsulation suits made of special coated fabric such as DuPont's Teflon onto the Nomex or fiberglass may be needed. So you have already seen in the table where the polytetrafluoroethylene, which is the Teflon, was used for the chemical protective clothing. This also can be used so that this kind of a coating, Teflon coatings, can be made onto the fiberglass or Nomex type of a fibers. So there are other products also, various nylon, cotton, polyesters. These fabrics also can be used, but the coating is very much required, like butyl, polyvinylene chloride or neoprene. This has a good barrier properties, so that the person who is wearing the garment, he can be resisted from the liquid and the gas from going inside the garment. So there are other many laminates are there. So what is the final understanding from this discussion? For particulate type of a protection, you require a porous fabric, but there you do not bother about the liquid or gas penetration. But whereas here, wherever the liquid and gas protection is required, you need to make a laminated type of a structure. That is why you need to make a multi-layer structure which contains some four layers. The thing which you should need to know is the layer which is near to the skin, that should allow the water vapor to pass through. Then only the person who is wearing will not get any kind of a heat stress, or during the cool climate he will not get any kind of a cooling problem also. But outer layer can be made with any kind of a fiber which can provide the strength, and inner layer also should be made in such a way that it should have a good transmission properties. It should allow the water vapor whichever is generated from the body through the sweat, that should be allowed to go outside. But the outer layer should not allow the chemical or the gas to go inside, and also it should have a good strength also. This is the criteria that should be remembered. So now we have come to the end of the lecture. What is the summary? We have seen what is meant by chemical protective clothing to protect the person from the attack of chemicals. Next, we have seen the number of chemical hazards, like various types of hazards we have seen, like toxic, reactive, many hazards we have discussed. Then there are four levels of protection are important, like A, B, C and then D. So each level of protection, when the alphabets increase, the intensity reduces. So the highest protection is given by the A protection, which is an encapsulating suit. Then we have seen the types of chemical protective clothing, like encapsulating and non-encapsulating type of a clothing. Then we have seen the materials used, like various types of materials we have used, like all are mostly chemically inert materials. Then we have moved on to discuss about types of chemical protective textiles. There are three types which are very important. One is the particulate protection, and another is the liquid and gas protection, and number three is the chemical and biological type of a protection. So in our next lecture, we will discuss further about in detail about the chemical and biological protection, and about the importance of seam also, and also the testing of the chemical protective clothing. I hope you have understood about the chemical protective clothing. So I am stopping here. We will continue our lecture in the next class. Thanks for listening. Have a nice day.